announcements out of the way. The reason why we had these other groups up here, by the way, we're the Redlands Pride Patriots, but we have Mountain Republican Club, we have We the People Rising, we work with all these other groups. Why is that? Because we're part of a broader coalition called Unite IU. We realized after the 2012 election that we have these little isolated groups that don't even know each other.
Yeah.
Whereas the left is all working together.
Yeah.
From the unions,
correct,
to the Muslim groups, to the LGBT groups, Q, whatever number of letters they have on that, to the unions, the whole parameter, the environmentalists, they all work together, and our side wasn't. So that's why we're supporting, whenever we can, we support other groups like We the People Rising in the work that they're doing. Now, what you've been waiting for? Welcome to the 2018 Political Hunger Games. May the odds be in your favor. But seriously, we're so pleased that Travis Allen and John Cox have selected our group and the Unite IE activists out here in the audience for their first debate. We think that is significant because it shows a new focus on the grassroots by the two principal candidates for governor. This is a crucial time in America and in California, the sanctuary state law just being one example.
Yes.
It's important that we choose the right person to lead the effort to try to take back California. So even if you have a favorite now, we encourage you to listen and keep an open mind. We'd also like to thank our owners, Jim and Mary Beth, that opened up their saloon for the big night. The only good thing is, if you don't like it when the candidate says, or your favorite candidate makes a mistake, you can always order another drink. I see some candidates about 40 lined up there at that bar.
Like beer pong, right?
One, to help make the case to the broader range of Californians, the working men and women of California.
Working men and
after
women.
After decades of corrupt, incompetent, leftist Democrat government.
Yep.
They
including Schwarzenegger
deserve a change. In the words of Senator Jeff Sessions, somebody who will serve their
you're right, I apologize. I will take that back. I apologize.
And second is to help our audience here and those who are going to watch this on YouTube or on Facebook Live, which of these two candidates can best lead that effort. Our format tonight is we're going to start with opening statements from the candidates of 5 minutes. We'll then have 10 questions from our panelists. There'll be 2-minute answers. And then we're going to have some audience questions in your speech with the panelist questions. And those will be 90-second answers. I will ask follow-up questions or allow additional time if I think the discussion warrants it. We've asked you to write out your questions, but we're not going to pre-screen them. You get to read your questions. We ask to write them out. So when you come up to the microphone, you're better prepared to ask a succinct, focused question. Do you want to ask a question?
Not a speech.
You'll line up back here at the start of the tables, and when time for audience questions, I will take the in order of the line. And I think that about covers our groundwork.
It'll be at the after the we'll back and forth.
Before we bring our candidates up.
What?
The candidates are most likely going to agree on 95% of all the issues and all the questions.
We'll see.
And it'd be very easy then to focus on things like John Cox, Gordon McDonald, for Gary Allen, Gary Johnson in 2016. Travis Allen made some contributions to Democrats. And John Cox made a contribution to an organization that may be somewhat connected to George Soros, and so on. And those may be valid points and things that you may want to consider. But we hope that the debate tonight will go beyond that.
Substantive.
We'll focus on which of these candidates has the vision, has the leadership.
I supported a Democrat in the third.
The working men and women of California,
because
that he and the Republican Party will serve your interests in the ways that the corrupt, incompetent, leftist Democrat government has not. Our first candidate tonight. And Travis Allen did ask me to introduce John Cox first on the theory of age before beauty.
Wow.
My wife is here, so she might
John Cox describes himself as a Jack Tim style Republican. He grew up in Chicago before coming to California. He has formed an organization that repairs homes for seniors.
I wonder if dead people voted for him.
He's mobilized 20,000 volunteers to repair more than 1,000 homes. He's built his own business to an asset of more than $200 million with 100 employees.
And that's the money he's using.
John lives in San Diego with his wife, and they're active and attend an activity Catholic church. And John is also very concerned with cleaning up corruption of special interest money in government, particularly in Sacramento. Welcome, John Cox. He with the 72nd Assembly District in Orange County since 2012. He has his own business in the investment consulting business. He's also very active in charities and supporting, including causes to support Israel.
Yes! Sorry.
And the most important distinction is
Robin.
Travis Allen has much better tan.
I was in Torrance and there was an anti-Semite there. It's everywhere.
You will have the best mic is here, so you will share the mic when you're speaking. You may sit down or stand up when you're not speaking.
Why don't you just get up there, please?
May the odds be ever in your favor.
May the best man win. The better man win.
opening statements, Craig?
Opening statements? You want to lead off?
I'll go ahead. Age before beauty. Is that good? Okay. Are you ready for a Republican governor in 2018? I am. And we elected a Republican businessman who was going to drain the swamp. How about a Republican businessman who's going to clean out the barn in Sacramento? How about that, huh? I want to accomplish a number of things here tonight. And first of all, I want to tell you who I am. I want to tell you why I'm doing this. And I want to tell you how I can win this campaign and bring California back into fiscal sanity once more. And we're going to do that. First of all, who am I? I was born on the south side of Chicago. My mother was a single mom raising four kids. She was a school teacher. I moved out to California, discovered California is even more corrupt than Illinois. Hard to believe.
Oh, God.
I worked my way through school, yes. I worked my way through school. I finished college in 2.5 years because I was paying for it. My daughters took 5 years because I was paying for it. I started my own business when I was 24 years old. So yes, I've been in business for almost 40 years, working hard every single day in a small business. I've been very blessed, very fortunate. My business now has almost 100 employees. I've also been very, very blessed to be married to a wonderful woman, and she's right here today, Sarah, my wife. Thank you for being here. I also want to introduce my youngest daughter. I have four daughters, by the way. Four daughters and two female granddaughters, by the way. My daughter, Julianne. Thanks, honey, for being here. What you need to know about me is that I'm just like all of you. I'm a conservative activist. I go back a long, long way. Yes, Travis, a long way. 1987, I was on Jack Kemp's presidential steering committee when he ran for president. And I believed in Jack Kemp. I think we would have had a much better country today if we had Jack Kemp elected as president. Because Jack Kemp believed in entrepreneurship and opportunity and a welcoming nation. But I didn't just stop there. I stayed involved all the way. I was one of the first members of the Club for Growth with Larry Kudlow and Steve Forbes. So I have connections all over the country from that.
Well,
when
good.
I moved out here,
they're
I
not
stayed
open border
involved.
People.
I was Newt Gingrich's finance chair in 2012.
Oh.
That's a true conservative to be Newt Gingrich's finance chair. I didn't stop with that, by the way. I also got involved. I was right here in 2012. I gave a speech right in this venue. I gave $100,000 to Proposition Proposition 32, remember that?
Yes.
Paycheck protection, and I was here speaking to this very group about that important idea. I also funded the recall of Bob Filner. Remember Bob Filner?
Filthy Filner.
Yeah. He was a living, breathing embodiment of what we have to do about this government that we have. And I'm going to tell you, that's the reason why I'm running for governor. I'm not running to get another leg up or to get my name or face on billboard. My wife is scared to death of that. I'm running for governor because this state needs to be transformed.
I know.
I remember my mom went to school in Berkeley. She remembered the wonderful growth of California, the California dream. Remember that?
Yeah.
It wasn't just the mamas and the papas. It was people that came from all over the world to get a sample of the opportunity that California can offer. And it's no more. This state has the highest poverty rate in the country. 1/3 of our residents are on Medicaid.
Something's wrong with that.
Our education system spends one of the top amounts in the country, yet our results are down around the low 40s. Our roads are a disaster. We need to get government back through our hands. We need to make sure that the cronies and the corrupt are out of government. Now, why can I win? Because I'm running against the special interest corruption in Sacramento. I have a plan, and Gavin Newsom is a walking, living embodiment of special interest corruption. And when I'm in that debate with Gavin Newsom, I'm going to be talking about the plan that I have to bring the government back to the people and get rid of the special interest influence. That's how I am going to win this campaign. I ask for your support, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. Thank you.
What a beautiful crowd. How's everybody doing tonight?
Ouch.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've been impressed.
John didn't raise his hand there, buddy.
Okay, I never wanted to be in politics. I was born down in San Diego. I was raised 5 minutes from the border. But you know what? I had to watch as my parents left the state, my brother left the state. My best friend now lives in Texas, where he doubled the size of his house, doubled the size of his business, and he pays no state income tax. I own an investment company, and I still work every single day because I don't believe that your politicians should be full-time politicians. That's why I just introduced legislation for a part-time legislator, so the legislature has to go back and work in real jobs just like all of us, pay taxes, and live under their own state laws. You know, I've seen my clients now since 1996. I started out investing just here in California for California clients. My clients now live in 22 states around the nation. Quick show of hands, who here knows anybody who's left the state of California? Keep your hands up if you ever thought about leaving the state yourself.
Oh, never.
Right? I am tired of this. That's why in 2012 I stood up and I said, no more. It is time to fight. I went and I got myself elected, but you know, let me take you a step back. Because the guy sitting behind me, the guy who needs you to support our Republican nominee for president,
ouch,
wants to try to take shots at me for being the only true conservative in the race. I will tell you something. In 2010 and 2011, I was a business owner, and I attended some events. At the request of some of my friends, they said, hey, come on down and see these guys speak. And so I went. I bought tickets to these events. And you know what? When I sat there and I had to listen to these Democrats, the light went in my head. The light bulb just went off. And I said, wait a second. This is what's wrong with California. This is why my parents have left. This is why my brothers left. This is why my clients are in 22 states around the nation, and my best friend is in Texas, and my other best friend left the country, and he's now in Puerto Rico. California has to be saved. It's got to be turned around. And right then and there was what galvanized me to go run for political office, and that's what I did. In 2012, I was the underdog. I was not supposed to win. There was another Republican in the race, a so-called Republican, right? This guy wouldn't even sign something called the No New Tax Pledge. Because, you see, he wanted to get up to Sacramento, and he didn't want his hands tied. He wanted to be able to make those special deals with those special interests so he could jack up our taxes, which are already among the highest in the nation. I signed that No New Tax Pledge, and since I've been in office, every single day I have fought for you, and I have never once voted to increase your taxes. Let's hear it. The Howard Jarvis Taxpayer Association, the California Taxpayer Association, the National Federation of Small Businesses, because at every single juncture, I have fought for the little guy in California, because I want my parents to come back to the state. I want my brother back in the state. I want my best friend to say, you know what, Travis? Texas is great, but the weather's better. I'm coming back to California. That's why we win in 2018.
That's why I stay.
We have to recognize that there is a true patriot in this room among many others. And I, before we get too far in the evening, I just want to recognize a guy who has shown me what strength in Sacramento looks like. He is sitting in the back of the room. His name is Tim Donnelly. Let's hear for a true American patriot. Ladies and gentlemen, State Assembly Travis Allen, and I will be your next governor of California. I will set a 5-point plan. Cut taxes. Get tough on crime. Fix our roads. Expand our freeways. Fix our broken education system. And finally, complete our state water projects so that we longer have these crazy droughts every 10 years.
Secure the border.
In my first 100 days in office, I have already vowed to reverse the sanctuary state.
Build the wall!
Thank you, gentlemen.
Secure the border!
Thank you. Now, Timekeeper Dale stands up. Please respect that. Finish your sentence if you want to, but you try to respect the time limits. So both
that's what needed to be on the floor. The Senate Bill 54.
We're going to start with questions from our panelists, and we're going to lead off with Judy Neal from the Ladies First, the Non-New Republican Club.
Masoye. I couldn't help myself.
Today's law enforcement is having their ability to serve and protect shackled by the passage of Sanctuary State Bill.
Yes.
The safety and security of all our citizens, especially seniors, are prime targets for fraud. What will you do to protect all the citizens and allow our law enforcement to do the jobs they were hired to do?
Beautiful.
We're going to alternate, so when Travis will take this, we'll speak first on this question, then John, and we'll reverse it for the next question. 2 minutes.
Okay, great. 2 minutes is too long.
California has this great law, it's called three strikes, right? When we passed three strikes, crime went down dramatically in California. But because of Jerry Brown and the California Democrats, who passed AB 109, Prop 47, and Prop 57, criminals are now getting out of jail early, felonies are turning into misdemeanors, and violent crime is up over 15.4% since 2014 alone. We must reverse Prop 47, we must reverse AB 109, and we must get rid of Prop 57, because we gotta make our communities safe again, right? Federal immigration law.
Yes! Yes!
It's very simple. The federal government controls our borders.
Robin,
it's time we secure our borders.
Yes!
California will no longer be a sanctuary state under Governor Travis Allen.
Yes!
There is no reason that people who are not in our state here legally should be sheltered with your taxpayer dollars. Do you agree?
Yes!
There is no reason Jerry Brown should take $50 million of the most recent budget and put it into legal defense funds for people who are not in our state legally. That's your money.
No, get rid of it.
There is no reason that they should be writing bills to spend $1 billion of your taxpayer funds to provide health care for people who are not in our state legally. Do you agree?
Yes!
California is first and foremost for California citizens.
Yes!
This is a great thing. We welcome everybody into our country, but you better come in the front door and you better come in the right way. Let's get tough, let's reverse the sanctuary state, and let's respect federal immigration law. I don't know if you saw that. Let's get Trump as Sessions to sue California.
Yeah!
On my first day in office, I will take whatever action I can take as the chief executive to end the sanctuary state enforcement. It is beyond ridiculous that we have public officials who thumb their nose at Washington and believe that they are right in not enforcing and not cooperating with federal law. That's like George Wallace standing in front of a schoolhouse in Alabama saying he's not going to live up to federal law. We need to make sure that all federal law is enforced. I agree with Travis on most of what he said. I want to point out one thing. You know the reason why the politicians were all about passing Prop 47 and 109 and all these bills to reclassify felons as misdemeanors and to let people out of jail? Because we can't afford to keep them. We've got prison dentists making $800,000 a year.
Outrageous.
Go look it up. It's all about
That's right.
political corruption.
Yep.
I'm going to make the case all across this state that the cronies who give money to the state legislature and to the governor are controlling the state and running this state down and making it unsafe for all of us. I got to tell you, I love Travis's enthusiasm and his great things, but you know what? If you can't get it done, it's going to result in another Arnold Schwarzenegger. Anybody interested in another Arnold Schwarzenegger?
No!
Is get the cronies out of power. We've got to get the special interests, the big unions, and the big businesses out of power and put the people back in charge.
That's
and
right.
I got to tell you, that's what the voters want, and that's why they will elect me as the next governor of California. Thank you.
I want to hear about ending. How about ending the public sector union tomorrow?
That's my first follow-up question. SB 54 is now the law, state law. Governors can't repeal. Both have a chance to recall. Governors can't repeal state law, so
but they can ignore
it. Assuming one of you is elected, how are you going to? And there's no initiative which overturns it. How are you going to overturn California's sanctuary law when the legislature is still controlled by the Democrats? Travis McStarr, 1 minute.
So this is very simple. Last year, I introduced legislation to defund any sanctuary jurisdiction in the state.
Robin,
of
you know
California.
About that, don't you?
Right. This, of course, was killed by all the Democrats. But it's very simple. See, I've already vowed to reverse the illegal sanctuary state in my first 100 days in office. The question is, well, how do you do that? Because the governor can't write laws. You only get to approve them or veto them. So what I will do is, in the first 100 days, I will gather the necessary signatures, and I will use that very special power of governors to call a special election and put it before the people of California in the first 100 days to reverse Jerry Brown's illegal sanctuary state.
I would like bring them into the legislature and lock the door until they change it.
And when I'm elected governor, we're going to make sure that we have a legislature that will listen to the people. I mean, right now, you know it. We have a supermajority working against her. I don't believe
not anymore
governor because you can't get anything done in the assembly. What we need to have is a legislature that's going to actually do what we want it to do. And we can get a vote of the people on a particular issue, but I want California transformed up and down the state. I want to make sure that we end the sanctuary state movement, but I also want to make sure that we get economic sanity back here, that we get affordability in the state, that we get an end to the cronyism and the regulations that are just choking off small business. We absolutely need to make sure that we end the sanctuary state nonsense, but we also need leadership that's going to have a legislature that's going to listen to the people and not the cronies.
The governor can issue an executive order not to comply.
Okay, next question.
Simple as that.
In 1963, the
governor of Maine did.
Alabama Governor George Wallace defied federal desegregation
here we
orders
go again.
By refusing to allow two black students to enter white schools. As a result, President Kennedy federalized the Alabama National Guard to enforce compliance. In 2016,
Eisenhower.
California legalized marijuana and created the sanctuary state,
I asked about that.
Two state laws that openly flout federal law. As governor, would you encourage the state to take such extraordinary measures to enforce federal law in California?
The question is, would I take extraordinary measures to enforce federal law?
To also to bring the president in as
Well, there's no question, as governor of the state, I will work with Washington, D.C., and President Trump, who may have voted for him, but I really like what he's doing as president of the United States. And we have to work together to keep the state secure. We need to make sure that we're not at odds. And absolutely, I will work with federal law enforcement. I think of the young woman who was murdered, not Kate Steinle, but another one that didn't get the publicity. I think she was from Modesto. And her husband was going after her, and the police picked him up as an illegal alien. And instead of informing her, they just let him go. Let him go, and didn't inform the local authorities. And of course, he went out and murdered her. I mean, we have got to make sure that we take a stand that the law has to be enforced. The rule of law is sacrosanct. You know, countries like Venezuela and Cuba can flout the law. We have to make sure that the law is enforced, that people respect the law. If we don't like the law, we can work to change it, but we need to make sure that the primacy of law, that's what separates us from chaos and anarchy.
Let me answer this question directly. I was on Carson Tucker two nights ago, and I very simply said, President Trump, Jeff Sessions, come to California,
sue the state.
It is very simple. The political system in California is broken. The legal system in California is broken.
Yeah.
That's why I'm running to be the next governor of the state, because you got to fix it, and you got to fix it from the top. If we have problems in California that we cannot fix with federal laws, you better believe we call the White House and we say, sue California and let's get federal laws enforced. Take it to the Supreme Court, take it to our good buddy Neil Gorsuch, and let him sort it out. What do you say?
Yeah!
So it's very simple. We have this president, Barack Hussein Obama.
Right? Oh!
Did anybody here vote for Barack Hussein Obama?
Uh-oh.
Just checking.
Did he vote for Obama?
Barack Obama thought he was a law unto himself. Right? He thought he could write his own laws, and that's exactly what he tried to do. That is why President Trump's actions in the last year have been so phenomenal to undo the legacy of socialism and the rapid switch to the left that Obama brought in and Hillary Clinton was going to continue. This is what is at stake in California. Make no mistake, Gavin Newsom is the former mayor of San Francisco. This guy is to the left of Bernie Sanders. California cannot afford another Democrat in office. California cannot afford Gavin Newsom. That's why we have to take back California, enforce our laws, enforce federal laws, and make sure that the people of California come first.
Yeah!
Next question, Don Davis.
They do work better when they're on.
Governor Brown says man-caused climate change is the greatest threat facing California today. Do you believe in the concept of man-caused climate change?
That's the way to put it.
If you don't, what would you do to unwind the legislative and administrative priorities that Governor Brown has instituted in order to support that belief? And what do you feel is the greatest threat facing California today?
Well, the first thing I'm going to say is that the greatest threat facing California today is bankruptcy. And we're going to hopefully talk a lot about that. But I'm from Chicago, and I've been talking to my grown-up daughters in Chicago, and it hasn't gotten above 10 degrees in the last 2 weeks. You don't hear a lot about global warming when that happens, do you, huh? And they're having a bomb cyclone on the East Coast right now. Listen, there's a lot of opinions out there. You know, everybody has their own opinion. They're like rear ends, right? Everybody's got one. But I certainly want the air clean. I hope everybody wants the air clean.
Well, duh.
The air is a lot cleaner today. I can see Los Angeles most days. And there was a Republican that did that, George Bush, the Clean Air Act, right? We need to make sure that we have clean air, but we can't hamstring our economy. I applaud the fact that President Trump withdrew us from the Paris Accord, which
was
trillions to India and China and the rest of the world. We absolutely need to make sure that we have clean air. I certainly think that technology can be developed. I applaud that, but the greatest danger facing us is bankruptcy.
No.
I'm a CPA, I've drafted pension plans, I can see what Illinois is going through right now. And if you don't believe it can happen in California, wrong. We are facing an impending debt bomb that's bigger than any bomb cyclone in the weather system here. We need to make sure that we have a governor who can talk to the people of the state, who can work with a new legislature that's going to be composed of the people and not the cronies, so that we can solve this pension bomb and make sure that we have a sustainable state going forward for our children.
You know, who here is a fan of Jerry Brown?
Boo!
What, 16-year governor? What has the movie given us? Absolutely nothing but more taxes, crumbling infrastructure, and now one in five Californians lives in poverty.
Yep.
The biggest problem facing California today is the high cost of living, skyrocketing crime, and Californians leaving the state, and the ones that are staying. There's this two-tier system in California where one in five live in crushing,
illegal immigration,
crushing poverty. Jerry Brown's solution, of course, is cap and trade. Jerry Brown wants to convince Californians that man makes climate change somehow, right? And the only solution for this is to tax you more money.